Thank you very much. So first of all, we would like to thank you for attending this talk, because we know that there are other sessions very interesting at the same time, so it's difficult to choose. So my name is Sara Nieto, and my colleague Pilar Teodoro, both working for the European Space Agency in the facility in Madrid. So today we are going to talk about how do we work with the Postgres database in the context of the astronomy, which is a very awesome project, so in the context of the Euclid mission. So this is the overview of the presentation. So first of all, we will go into the context of the European Space Agency, and then we will present the application that runs on top of Postgres, which is the Euclid archive, and we will present the different testing that we have done in the context of, the database, and finally we will present the final conclusions that we got from this work. So first of all, the introduction of the European Space Agency. The European Space Agency is an intergovernmental organization, so the members have 22 up to now, and Canada is an associated member. So these are the different establishment facilities of ESA across Europe. So currently we're working on the Spain facility in Madrid, which is ESA, which is devoted to the Science Operations Center and is devoted to host the archives for the different missions at ESA. So, just to put some figures, last year ESA managed more than 5,000 million euros of the budget. So across the different projects, it's distributed into Earth, Earth observation missions, launch, and many other projects that you probably already know, like Rosita, and many other missions that are very, very exciting projects. But today we are going to focus on the work on the Postgres database work that we have been performed in the context of the Euclid mission. So Euclid is a spacecraft that will be launched at the end of the 2020, and its main goal is to answer and to understand the nature of dark energy and dark matter, which is 95% of the universe, where only 5% is considered ordinary matter. So it's a very exciting mission. So it contains two different instruments. We have one optical instrument, which is basically a camera that is taking images from the space. And we have another near-infrared instrument that will take images also, and a spectra. So we have different kinds of data coming from the space, from the Euclid mission. So we have, just to put some details, we have a 1.2 meters telescope, and the spacecraft will be put into a stable orbit, so to avoid any kind of perturbation. So ESA is, of course, responsible for the mission, but it's a joint collaboration between ESA and what is called the Euclid Consortium, and US is participating into this consortium. It has more than 2,000 members and more than 130 institutes participating, and it's a huge collaboration, so it requires a massive coordination effort across different data centers. So let's go into the production of the data. Euclid will produce an amazing amount of volume of data. So we are talking about petabytes of information. It will produce up to 26 petabytes per year of information. And it will produce also a catalog, which is basically a collection of objects seen in the space. And that will be the first master version, will be up to 10 billion rows, collecting different metadata from the space, like the brightness of the stars, like the position of the stars, and many other metadata that can be interesting to make science from that. So, as I said, at ESA we host the archives of the different missions of ESA. So the archives are basically the applications in charge of storing, but also publishing the data to the user's community, to the public community, and that allows the interfaces, the proper interfaces, to make science with this data. So, in the context of Euclid, this is basically the architecture. We have two different subsystems. One is the purple one that is devoted to the processing, all the products that are produced inside the different data centers are registered against this archive for the processing. And then, according to the different public releases, they are transferred from this purple system to the blue one, which is the science archive system, which is the one hosted at ESA, which is the one that we are currently working on the implementation. So The purple one is the data processing system is developed by one of the science data center inside the consortium of Euclid, which is located in Holland. And as I said, the scientific archive system is responsible for it and is developed at ISAC in Madrid. So going back to the data releases, as I said, the first date will Euclid will have three data releases. The first one will be after 26 months after the launch. So we will have at least 10 terabytes of data that will be in the catalog and up to 5 petabytes of images that we have to store and to serve to the public. So we have a very high level challenge to address inside the Euclid archive. So now Pilar will explain the details about the Postgres testing that we have performed in the context of this, in the context of the archive.
Okay. Let's see. Hello. So the idea is that in our system, the Euclid mission is part. So as Sara said, we have the processing system and the archive system. Even if we are working in the same mission, the development teams are different. So the people who has developed the processing system is in Holland. And we at ISAC are in Madrid. And the team is different, but also we can use different databases to connect. So the idea and the topic of this presentation is how to transfer the data between Oracle and Postgres. Because then later we'll see, and maybe for another PGCon, if finally we convert this Oracle database into another database provider, probably Postgres. But the idea of this presentation is to speak about the metadata transfer system. So how are we going to pass the data from Oracle to Postgres? Why Oracle first in the source, as a source database? Well, in Holland, they were using an astronomy tool called AstroWise that was based in Oracle, so it was easy to make the prototype in Oracle. On the other hand, at ISAC, in the archives team, we are used to work with Postgres. Most of our databases are Postgres, and also because we have the knowledge in the team, and because this is a database that we rely on for the future. Because as you can imagine, so in every mission, in every project, there will be different phases. So we have development, operations, and then this part of operations that will show the data, as Sara explained with the releases, to publish the data first for the consortium, then to the public, and then a legacy archive. The budget at the beginning is very high, continues growing, but then goes down very fast. So for the legacy system, our budget will be low, and Postgres will make us a good work to continue with it. So different tests has been done. So we have used the technology of Oracle Golden Gate, the foreign data wrappers, using also materialized views at the creatable as select, and finally files that will store in the Postgres repository, in as Sara will explain later. But let's have a look at our data, because it's not very simple. So this is a reduced part of the data model that is running for the Euclid Common Data Model. Only here is we are showing what is called by the optical, what is seen by the optical telescope and the visual images. So you can see in Oracle, we are using it as an object-oriented database. Well, I forgot to tell you that even this is developing in Holland, everything will run in Spain. So just for next year, we will be masters of everything. Now we are a replica of them, but then we are using Oracle Data Guard for this, but then we will be the masters in Spain. So you can see here the complexity, and we have to simplify that to come to the archives. This is our model for the archive system that responds also to the necessity that we have, and also is similar to other archives, so we have the experience of this. So how to transfer this data from one database provider to another. Golden Gate. How many here have used Golden Gate? Very good, so pretty, yeah. And what is your experience? You like it? Good. Okay, so just one slide to explain what is the hardware that was used to make the test. So our budget now is limited as development, and for this test we just use one node with 128 gigabytes of RAM, but we have here more databases, but we have configured one in Oracle and 11G with 20 gigabytes for SGA, and then the Postgres, the latest version with 20 gigabytes for the shared buffers. So we use SSD disks and 16 CPUs. But coming to Oracle Golden Gate. So for those who don't know what is Golden Gate, is a tool, a very powerful tool that Oracle bought in 2009, and the idea was to replace the Oracle streams. I don't know if someone here worked with Oracle streams, but they know there is a pain. And so the idea is that Golden Gate is much easier to use and is really good. It can be used with different databases, not only Oracle. I can use unidirectional data replication, so it's for replication, or bidirectional, but for our purposes, the idea is to move from Oracle to Postgres, of course, and only one sense. So the idea then for Oracle Golden Gate is that we have a source database, okay, our Postgres, then we will have a extract process defined that is listening to the changes, the DML and the DDL changes done in the Oracle database. This will be written in trail files sent to the target destination, and then another processes listening in another port will that is called the replicate, then we'll apply them to the target database. So this is pretty simple and it's straightforward once your configuration is done. The problem is this configuration at the beginning. Once this is done, it goes straightforward, has discard files, you can reprocess, etc. It's very powerful. So we have some slides like can serve as tutorial for the Oracle Golden Gate, apart from going out to see some numbers, but as we have only 50 minutes, we will put them in the final slides that we will be upload, I think, next week. So on a case that you are interested, we can show you later. But the idea then with Oracle Golden Gate is that to get some numbers, so if we ingest into a table that here, for example, it was a table of 700 megabytes with 6.7 million rows that is keeping the information of the camera, of the Euclid camera at pixel level, that is not very well, but to show you what we have. So to ingest this data into using a database link from another database in Oracle, so this will take like 5 minutes. But when we pass it to Postgres using Golden Gate, it only takes 25 seconds, so for transfer and apply. So this is pretty fast. Can seem. So this is 28 megabytes per second, so it's good. But what's the problem of Oracle Golden Gate? So, pricing. I don't know. I don't know because this is a joke in Spanish, but Oracle, in the other way read, is el caro, which means the expensive. So, it's clear what happens with Oracle. Okay? So, the idea then is that it has a lot of pros, because it's almost real-time replication. And also, the support from Oracle, we know it, is good. So if you say which database you want to use, okay, Oracle, but maybe you cannot afford it because you have to look into the long term. So the cons will be the pricing. And another important point, it will be that it doesn't replicate views, the Golden Gate, because if you have to make any update in the view, then it will do it through the table behind, okay? So it can replicate materialized views. But then it will mean that in our DPS side, we have to ask the developers from the other system to create us these materialized views and update them and maintain them correspondingly. So there are many workarounds, but none straightforward, right? So foreign data wrappers, I'm sure most people here will have worked with foreign data wrappers, am I right? How many people have worked with foreign data wrappers? Yeah, more than Golden Gate. So it's clear. So foreign data wrappers. So foreign data wrappers are used to connect different database providers. So it can be Postgres, Oracle to Postgres, MySQL to Postgres, Mongo to Postgres, CSV. So at the archives team, we have the experience to have done it with MySQL, with Oracle, and Postgres to Postgres. It's very powerful. And the good thing is also that we don't have to take all the information from the source database. We can, what the foreign data wrapper does is to connect to the server and pull the data from it, okay? And so, and also the good thing is that if we don't put any function or whatever, the execution plan is used in the Oracle one. So this is very good for us because the query is resolved in Oracle. And so just to acknowledge, this is written by Laurent Salve, and the version we were using for this test is the 1.5.1. And for Postgres, as I said, it was the 9.6.2, and Oracle is the 11G. So finally, another very important point for us from the development point of view is that we have to make a mapping between the tables in one system to the other. As I saw, we saw, is that our system in the DPS is very complicated, and so we asked them finally to create some views to check how this will work, and that will match our system in the SAS, in the scientific archive system. So we had foreign tables reading from the origin, and that will match our tables, but also can be splitted in several information. Okay, so this is very powerful for us. And one thing that we like very much from 9.5 is the import schema. Because before you have to explicit which tables you like, you have to make the mapping with the data types and everything, and with the import schema and the limit to for 1,000 tables, it's very easy to make the limit to some of them only, and then to ingest them in the schema that we need. So then, after, if you use foreign data wrappers, only if your table is very small, you will use it directly every time to the source. But, so the normal thing is that you create a foreign table, and then you will materialize it to be able to index it and to do and add more columns, add functions to columns, or to create table as select. This was before the materializing views was existing. There was this lazy updates, eager updates, I'm sure that you have used it as well. And so also the good thing of creating a table instead of using the materialized views is that we can use triggering with the tables. So one important point also of this approach will be the refreshes. So what's the problem with the refreshes? So if we refresh a materialized view, we will have a lock in the table. So we will not be able to access it while it's being refreshed. That's why from 9.5, the refresh concurrently was done. This is very good because this will make an access to the table, and the way that the refresh is done is using is transferring all this data to a temporary table and comparing the results with the first one. What is the problem? Well, first of all, this will need a unique index to make these comparisons. But also, the problem will be that this takes longer. And of course, if the vacuum is not done after the refresh concurrently, as we have created another temporary table, our size of the database will grow. So instead of having a 70 gigabytes database, you can be with 700 gigabytes, and you don't know why. So this is something that has to be taken in mind. And on the other hand, we have the create table as select, where you can just throw the changes, apply the changes, so to have some logical behind than manually, but it works. So for some numbers. So this is the data types mapping that done by the Oracle, by the foreign data wrapper. So for us, we are lucky because we don't have much problems with the data types that we use, but this can be also important. So let's see some of the tests we have done. So first of all, as I said, it's very important to know what we will have in the source database, if it's a table or it's a view that will be resolved there. So if we have a table, for example, we create this table. In Postgres, then we create the foreign table using the connection, the server connection, that is using one schema and the table name. Then we can create the table in Postgres and make an insert, because then this can be in different steps, right? So to make this insert, so the same as we saw with Oracle Golden Gate, here is taking longer, it's 50 seconds. Well, this test was done several times, but this is just a number, okay? So, and also the other way will be just to create from the beginning the table, so every time if we need, we just recreate the table. And also can add, as I said before, another type of columns, like for example, a sequence for an ID or whatever. and more or less takes the same. The good thing is that if we insert more data, like another 6.5 million, again, 6.5 billion, the time remains constant. So this is important also to know that it will not grow in time because our table is bigger. So, but if we do it with a materialized view, it's a little bit less time. But the thing is that here you cannot see very well the execution plan, but this is done in the source. You will see it in the slides if you download them. Then for the refresh materialized view, then we create the index and make and compare the refresh with the concurrent refresh, and we see really a difference here. And if we continue adding more rows, the difference is more evident. Okay, so this is for large tables, it's not very well recommended, although it has a very powerful use. So if instead we use a view in the origin, so our views are quite complicated, we use CTEs, the common table expressions, to connect different tables, as we have so many, the CTEs is very powerful to connect so many tables that inherits one from the others. And so then if we use views, we just see that the time is really much longer than if we use the table in the origin. And we can see here in the execution plan how this is resolved, this query in Oracle. Also, it's very important to acknowledge that the time for making a select count in Oracle, in the origin database, for example, for this table, a select count will be only 10 seconds. But if we use the foreign data wrapper directly to measure the latency between the transfer, is 3 times slower. So this is not synchronous, of course. But well, depending on your requirements, this can be very well done. So then we can consider these lazy updates, like saying, okay, every time in Oracle that we want to make a release, so we put a flag, let's say release number 1.2, and then we pass it to Oracle through a controls table, just saying where we are, right? So this will be very powerful as well, but also can take also the idea of the file ingestion. So just conclusions for this test. So if you can afford a synchronous transfer between Oracle and Postgres, the easiest way will be to use materialized views because it's really easy to implement, and the golden gate, because once the configuration is done, it's really good. Fastest, golden gate. Then the insert as select, more than the materialized views, really. No need of ad-hoc scripts to refresh, so nothing to touch after that will be the golden gate. The network latencies to take in mind, and in the relational model, always, even if the other team, we have to press to make materialized views and maintain them. So we need tables or materialized views in the source to pass the data, not to read from Postgres to Oracle to have a explain plan that is really doing many things because the joins are done in the origin database. So in the meanwhile, we will continue using Oracle foreign data wrapper because there is a chance that we change Oracle to another database provider, and we're pushing hard that this will be Postgres, but we have to see how we are going to handle these 1,000 rows with this object-oriented to be converted, okay? So I let Sara continue with the ingestion system.
Thank you. So as Pilar has explained, deriving from the fact that the implementation on the original side is quite complex because we have quite large data model in the origin, and we have many tables involved in the implementation on the Oracle side. This is we also explore the option to feed the scientific archive system directly from files. So this is the work that we have done. So we have a mechanism that allows us to ingest the XML metadata coming from the different data centers. So we ingest it into the Postgres SQL. So we have been done different tests. Run on Postgres SQL single instance and Postgres Excel, given the amount of data that we are going to manage. So this is the high-level description of this ingestion mechanism, where we have the XML metadata files coming from the data centers. So we have the first step is the binding of these XML files, and then we have this mapping, and then we have the ingestion on the database. So this is basically the process. So as Pilar has explained, this is the data model in the origin. That's as I said, this is only the part that corresponds to the visual instrument of the spacecraft. So there is another part corresponding to the other instrument and so on, and contains a lot of information about the processing. That's why it's more complex than the scientific archive system. Okay, so this is our model, and we have produced the mapping that, as Pilar has already explained, in the case of the mapping between Oracle and Postgres, it's done in a different way. And in the case of the file ingestion mechanism, we have to feed our system with a specific configuration file that produces this mapping. In this mapping, what kind of information that we are going to have is basically how to map the entities, how to map the fields, and how to map the data types, basically. So we have produced some figures for the ingestion up to, we have ingested into the Postgres single instance 9.6 up to 50,000 files, and we have retrieved this is very fast, in fact. And what we have realized is that the most of the time, the most demanding process of the ingestion is that the parsing, the reading and the parsing of the file, given that their files quite large, and we have to parse and then to filter and then to ingest it into the Postgres database. So for a single instance, we retrieve that for a single sequential scan of a table up to 100,000 rows, 56 milliseconds. So as I said, the most demanding and consuming time of the process is the unmarshalling, which is basically the parsing and the reading of the schema, and the insertion is basically zero compared to this, to the other steps. So we have done, as I said, the same test with the PostgreSQL configuration of the 9.5 version, and this is the first cluster that we have installed. We have three nodes, one global transaction manager, one coordinator, and three nodes, and the same capacity for the three nodes. One thing that we figure out with the schema, basically, in order to import the same schema that we have on the Postgres single instance into the Postgres Excel, is that we have to perform some changes on the schema. Basically, we have to decide which is the criteria to make the splitting of the tables across the different nodes. So that's why it's not straightforward to put a more or less quite complex data model into Postgres Excel. So it's not a direct, it's not a straightforward process. And we have to look into the specific queries that we are going to perform in order to speed up the not only the queries, but also the ingestion. So these are some figures. So from the ingestion point of view, we have not yet quite large improvements on the ingestion, but what we have seen, of course, is that it's three times faster on the queries. So regarding using PostgreSQL, we have to test so far different configurations, but we have found that we need to find the balance between the number of nodes and the volume of information that you want to distribute across the nodes. Because this type of architecture introduces overhead. So we have to take this in mind and perform different testing according to your specific needs. So apart from the test that we have done with a relational model, we have done the same test with a single table. And of course, we have obtained very good results with PostgreSQL. And we have for a single table of 16 million rows and select for everything, we have got that in Excel, it only takes 88 milliseconds compared to a single instance. With we have 540 milliseconds. So it's much faster. So as I said, these are the final conclusions about the ingestion testing with PostgreSQL. So the schema loading and unmarshalling, I'm talking about the ingestion process, is the most demanding phase. And PostgreSQL improves the query performance by a factor of three. And but as I said, it requires a specific modification on the schema. So you cannot import it as such into PostgreSQL. So what's next? We have to scale out this PostgreSQL infrastructure and continue increasing the nodes and the coordinators in order to find the better balance. And we will test the PostgreSQL partitioning and also another extension of PG of Postgres, which is PGStrom that runs on GPUs. So these are the next steps that we need to follow. And finally, to conclude, we want to show you what is the application on top of this database infrastructure and what is the application that is able to expose the data scientifically to the user. And first of all, this application allows, of course, the scientific access of the data, especially for Euclid. And this is how the archive looks like. This is the main homepage. And from here, you can do metadata parametric search. So we provide a specific interface that interfaces directly to the database. So it's important to say that for that, for this blank text over here, text area, it's mainly for ad-hoc, which is astronomical data query language, which is has inside a translator, let's say, that translates these specific astronomical functions into SQL. So for that, we use a specific Postgres extension like PGSphere and Q3C. So these are the list of queries that the user has already run. So the user can rerun queries and can basically download the results and share the results with the rest of the community and so on. But also allows you to display the results online. So this is in the format of a table. Let's say, as we explained before, the user can see specific stars, for instance, given in a specific region of the sky, and we can see a specific magnitude. Give me the stars brighter than a specific factor, so you can retrieve here the results. So you don't have to download on your local machine. And of course, as I said, Euclid will also produce maps, and this is the visualization online that we will have for the Euclid maps. So this will allow to explore the maps dynamically and to overlap the specific stars that goes into this region of the sky and see dynamically specific metadata on the sky. So the idea is basically to expose all the data in a very easy way for the user, but also to be able to make science with that. So it's very, very amazing. And this is basically the overview that the technology that we are using. We rely on Java, and we use Google Web Toolkit for the web application. And of course, we use Postgres and virtual observatory interfaces that basically allow us to interoperate our application with other interfaces inside the astronomy context. And finally, we rely on LDAP for the authentication purpose. So thank you so much for attending. If you have any question, we are happy to answer. Yes.
A couple of things. Number one, what kind of Postgres did you want for the data tool?
Sorry?
What kind of Postgres version did you draft for the data? Is it like open source community version?
Yeah.
Okay, so got it. And then you do not try putting up it on cloud or anything like that?
No.
On-prem Postgres?
Yeah. Yeah, this is another. It's a very good question, but in principle, the idea is to make science close to the data, basically. So all the infrastructure is planned to basically to provide a specific cloud storage and facilities to allow the user to run their own scripts close to the data, and basically this means close to the database. Well, this is about the triggering. How to start? Yeah, you can say yes.
No, we don't have this kind of application. We don't use triggers so far. Mm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Am I right that you have now two active databases, Oracle and Postgres? So you use them both.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And what about the limitations of the Postgres table size when you replicate the deep table?
That's why we are planning to, we are doing this test with Postgres Excel. We want to see also the other possibilities like Cirrus data. And so, because so far our database is only 300 gigabytes and we have to grow a lot. So we are really in the beginning.
Thanks.
Yes.
Is metadata.
Metadata, yes. Yes. Yes.
300 gigabyte size is just for metadata, right?
Yes. And this will grow up to more than 1 petabyte.
Yes, because across the different data releases, the data is going to reprocessed. So it's not only the data that comes from the spacecraft, but also the data that is going to be reprocessed that should be also made online. Yeah, the thing is that there are different, let's say, data models and different implementations. So, I mean, to compare different things, it's not
so... Currently, we are doing also some work, some benchmarks, because we want... So there is a request to study other possibilities than Oracle for the end of this year, and the first step is to transform, to convert the data model, which is not completely... As this, the Oracle is object-oriented, it's not straightforward to do it for Postgres, because there is a lot of make references and so that we have to translate. So we are still in this process. Probably we can present something next year.
In future. Yeah.
PGSphere, yes. Q3C, very powerful.
Mm-hmm.
PG Hilpix. As well,
Hilpix.
There is this kind of dividing a sphere into a small
areas,
areas, and again this again and again and again, and this is really also very powerful.
Can you talk more about the GPU things and what you're planning to do with that, and how that will help?
Well, we haven't looked deeply into that yet, but this is something that is in our plans because. Basically, we are talking about volume of data, and we need to know how to cope with that, and we need to speed up queries as much as possible. So that's the reason why we need to look into this extension. So first of all, we need to allocate the hardware to make the test. So this is basically our. But once we have started this testing, we will continue enlarging the Excel architecture to get the final results. And probably the next step would be to address this PG Strom thing.
What made you use Excel as opposed to other
sites? Yeah, this is a very good question, in fact, because we think about that. And basically, as we explained in the ESAC Science Data Center, we wanted to reuse the experience that we already have in Postgres. So that's mainly the reason why we explored this option instead of any other ones, but we are not close to that.
Yeah, I can add to this question is that there is another mission using Postgres Excel, Gaia mission. So based on their experience, we can learn. No, Golden Gate it was the most efficient. Yeah, but yeah, fastest. Probably not
less
file
adapters for the Golden Gate.
I don't know. We
it's
have not.
It's not supporting, I think, straight replication from Oracle to Postgres.
But as we are not using this kind of data types, or this is for us, it will be straightforward to move to one table to another. So it's not complex model in that sense. Do you use green plan? Ah, that's good.
Yes, so because it's on Postgres, and Oracle does not support Oracle to green plan replication, straight replication. We use a lot Oracle to Oracle, but Oracle with green plan, we're not supposed to use a flat file adapter, and it's actually, it's...
We can talk later, yeah, there will be testing.
Yeah. Well, for the first time, we will start from scratch. But basically, before each data release, we will have to transfer some data before. That will be only made available for the consortium members first.
So how are you going to do that initial transfer of the data?
In the same way, basically. It's using the same procedure.
Yeah.
Well, actually, Golden Gate is very probable that we will not use it.
Yeah, so maybe your question is more focused on the triggering mechanism, how to start the process. So, no? Okay, so it's okay.
Well, not the same. We can only do it for, as we said, so imagine there is a release, so we have to put a flag on the Oracle side and say in only this part. So we use with the where clause the ones that we want to move.
Yes, because we have the scientific, let's say, we have put the scientific way, the data processing system, so there is this layer on top.
Yeah, also because in the Oracle side, there is a row level security and everything. So not everybody can see everything and so on. So this makes things more complicated. So these views on top of the Oracle database help us a lot to know what we have to transfer.
Right, right. No, I was asking whether you were trying to like take an initial snapshot
and
then keep the changes up to date.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
But this will be but from this side.
Okay.
Yeah. This is something that we would like to address because the table size that we are managing, especially for the catalogs, it's up to 10 billion rows, and depending on the number of columns that we have, it's going to be the size. But we manage something like 10 terabytes of the table, of the catalog, so we have to split that, of course.
Okay.